Greetings from the Apollo Spectra Hospital, Brookfield. I am Dr. Pradeep Kumar, Senior Consulting Physician and Cardiodiabetologist practicing in this hospital over the past 10 years. Today we are here to discuss about the magnitude of cardiovascular diseases affecting our general population. The incidence of cardiac diseases in our community is to the tune of approximately around 65 million people in the entire country. In my regular day-to-day practice, one third of the patients that I see are having one or the other symptoms related to cardiovascular diseases. Now, how do we diagnose a cardiovascular disease? What are the symptoms do they come across with people having these cardiovascular diseases? How do we prevent these disorders? How do we treat them? These are the few points on which we are going to discuss in this specific video that we would want to telecast. The kind of patients whom we come across are a set of people who are in the age group of anywhere between 18 to 35 years age group, and the other set of patients who have between 50 to 75 years age group. The people who come with these disorders almost always have a genetic predisposition in one third of the patients. India unfortunately has got the worst incidence of cardiovascular diseases and diabetes. We are considered as the diabetes capital of the world, and we also have got the bane of having the highest amount of cardiovascular diseases. And all these things can be prevented to a very large extent by adopting a right kind of an approach on prevention and progression and management of these disorders. My advice to the general public is on identifying certain symptoms which predispose, which suggest a cardiovascular diseases. Shortness of breath, chest pain, irregularity in their pulse, blood pressure variations, intolerance to exercises. These are the certain vague symptoms that patients could present with. Unfortunately, not all patients with cardiac diseases have chest pain as a presenting symptom. They also have other symptoms like shortness of breath, inability to carry out their regular day-to-day activities. So, we need to have a wide range of suspicion to pick up these symptoms. The criteria for diagnosing any pain, a chest pain, to be of cardiac origin, they usually tend to have a pain which is there over the center of their chest. This is a pain which is described as a heaviness, which is described as a pain which is radiating towards the jaws, pain which is radiating towards the hand, pain which is radiating to the back. It is a sharp stabbing pain that they would have. This pain lasts for a few minutes, a few seconds to a few minutes. It is usually aggravated by exercises, and it is relieved by taking rest and on certain medications. This is also associated with sweating, sometimes an irregularity in their heartbeat, and shortness of breath. So when these conglomeration of symptoms occur together, they are more likely to be a chest pain of cardiac origin. We always tend to get misled by people who say that I had a heavy meal, I had some kind of a burning sensation in my chest. They can all be vague, atypical presentations of a chest pain. We have certain incidences where patients have neglected these symptoms, not reached the doctor in the right time, and they have passed off midnight because they have assumed that this chest discomfort and burning sensation was not part of heart origin. So having given you a brief about how these chest pain needs to be differentiated from a cardiac pain versus a non-cardiac pain, what do we do when it comes in? So it does not come out as a bolt from the blue. This has got a special predilection for certain individuals who are sedentary, who have a bad genetic aspect where both parents are having these disorders, people who have increased risk of smoking, people who are having a high risk of high cholesterol levels in their family, people who already have diabetes and hypertension. These are all the high risk group that we usually come across in our practice as people who have these cardiac disorders. So what do we do? The recommendation is that once you are above the age of 25 years, you need to get your annual health checks done, which would give you a basic understanding of what your base profile is. And get this periodic assessments done depending on the risk factors. You can probably do it once every 2 years, once every 5 years. Once you cross the age of 40, there is a recommendation that you need to do this checkup annually. And I recommend that this can be the best birthday gift that you could get, to get your heart checks done on an annual basis on your birthdays, in and around your birthdays. Now, what do we do in these health checkups? We do your cholesterol assessment, we do your blood sugar assessment, we do your ECG, we do an echo. In addition to getting your basic parameters like your blood pressures, pulse rates, and those vitals checked, this will give us a prediction of whether you fall into the low risk category, intermediate risk category, and the high risk category. Based on your grouping, we would give you specific recommendations. How do we go about treating these individuals who have cardiovascular diseases? The cardiovascular diseases can be acute or it can be chronic. The acute disorders can be grouped as anginal episodes or a frank myocardial infarction, which we broadly refer to as an heart attack. Now, this has got a very short window period. They need to reach the hospital within the first few hours, a couple of hours. The maximum window period that we have is anywhere between 2 to 4 hours, beyond which the treatment becomes less successful. So if you are able to reach the hospital within the short period and the golden hour, the doctors and the hospitals have got a very high chances of treating these heart attacks and minimizing any kind of a residual damage. So there is a pharmacological approach and there is an invasive approach, and there is a combination of these two put together, wherein we give you clot busters injections, and those injections can completely dissolve the blood clots that are there in the culprit blood vessel, and you can resume your activities back to normal within 24 to 48 hours. So that's what the benefit is if you're able to reach the hospital within the short period of time. Now, this is one method of approach. A second method of approach is, if we have found that there is a huge block in the main blood vessels of your heart, which has resulted in this heart attack, then we do what is called as an rescue angioplasty. We call this as primary rescue angioplasty, wherein we pass in a small guide wire through your blood vessels in the hand, reach up to the heart, visualize the blood clot, dissolve the blood clot, and put in a stent if it's required, and come out of it. And that's a 100% satisfying results that you would get. And this is the world's best approach that we have as far as acute management of heart attacks are concerned. There has been a lot of myth about the angioplasties being done, being inappropriate, hospitals tending to overdo this. Be rest assured that if this is the method of approach that a doctor is suggesting to you in an acute case scenario, you're probably being advised the right kind of an approach. But say, for example, this has been in a person who's already had a chronic cardiovascular disease over a period of time, running on to years, to months. In those situations, there is always a debate on whether this is the right approach or the wrong approach. That would preferably be done by an expert who would understand whether there is a viable myocardium or a viable heart muscle which is salvaged by doing this particular procedure. Then we do what is called as a myocardial perfusion studies. And when we do this, we know if we do a stenting, if we do a procedure, can we salvage these myocardium which has already been affected as a part of heart attacks. If they are salvageable, then we go ahead with this procedure. If they are not salvageable, then we go ahead with medications and managements, which are invariably lifelong. So this is the two broad categories of treatment. The essence of any treatment for a cardiovascular disease is, cornerstone is diet, lifestyle modifications, regular medications, and regular checkup. your diet, the dietitians and the treating doctor would be able to tell you on what could be the right kind of a diet that you need to follow. Reduction of your blood pressure, maintaining your blood pressure to target blood pressure levels. When I mean target blood pressure levels, the Indian Hypertension Society and the World's Hypertension Society have given a cutoff of a blood pressure as 130 by 90 for any age group. If your blood pressure is beyond this, you need to get treated irrespective of your age. Though we say there is a higher blood pressure as the age progresses, this does not necessarily mean to be a normal blood pressure, because as we know, there is thickening of the blood vessels which leads on to stiffening, and the heart needs to pump more to get over this stiffened blood vessels. So we need to treat these blood pressures to prevent the load on the heart so that your heart can function longer against this high blood pressures. So the cutoff blood pressure for anyone is 130 by 90, which is the upper values and the lower values. Similarly, for your blood sugars, for anyone to have a normal risk proposal as opposed to a non-diabetic individual, your HbA1c levels needs to be less than 7 to be on the safe values, where we can say that your risk is as less as a non-diabetic individual. So you should always aim at getting your HbA1c levels less than 7%, and this needs to be done every 3 months values. Now coming to the third parameter, it is your lipid profile, which understands your good cholesterols and your bad cholesterols. The good cholesterol is the HDL cholesterol. The higher the values, the better it is. All the other cholesterols, lower the values, the better it is. So we always aim at having an LDL levels less than 70 milligrams per deciliter. There has been a lot of circulation in the media, in the public, in the WhatsApp groups about inadvertent use of statins. As a treating doctor, I would mention this to you, that if there is one single drug that has claimed to enhance the lifespan of an individual, it is statins and statins alone. So my humble request to you is, don't get swayed by those articles that you come across in various non-qualified opinions that come across in the various platforms. There has been enough literatures, there has been enough research that has proven beyond doubt that the ideal levels of your blood cholesterol should be less than 150 milligrams if you are a diabetic patient, if you are an hypertensive patient, and if you are a cardiac patient. The values may be different if you are not any of these three, but if you are, then these are the values that we must target. Now, how do we go about treating these individuals, keeping your blood pressures right, keeping your blood sugars right, keeping your blood cholesterols right? Engaging yourself on a regular exercises is of paramount importance. You need to exercise a minimum of 60 minutes to 90 minutes every day, at least 5 days a week. This is what is recommended for a prevention of cardiovascular diseases. For a person who's already had a cardiovascular disease, a minimum of 30 to 45 minutes of a daily walk is recommended, and this is what we need to follow. Abstinence from smoking, moderate alcohol consumptions, ensuring that you are physically active are the cornerstones of prevention of cardiovascular diseases. The more number of patients that we see in our practice falling into these cardiovascular diseases is essentially because of our westernization in our dietary habits without engaging ourselves in physical activity. And my advice, a single line advice to our younger generation, is eat right, sleep right, exercise right, so that you can live a long and healthy life. All the very best. God bless you. Right knowledge is right health. If you like this video, kindly subscribe to this channel. Thank you.